the book just came out about a month ago, and I'm happy to be out doing events and presenting it. It comes out of my experience of growing up in California. As you heard, my research has been on the Civil War, and on my first book was about St. Louis, and my next book is about Detroit. But I grew up next to this mosaic. This mosaic was near the Grossmont Center Mall in La Mesa, California. It's actually a copy of a section of the Lombard Van Ness frieze, which Alan has brought us the sketch of over there, and we can go see afterwards if you're in the room. It's actually one of the only cases of an exact copy of artwork between two home saving sites. But thinking back on this artwork, when I had a chance to move back to California in 2010, it made me think about how, in many ways, this is one of the first pieces of history I may have seen. Because I used to go by this bank when I was going to Buffum's in Grossmont Center to have lunch when I was a preschooler. And so this image of these Franciscan friars and these vaqueros in this very ornate design, which is based partially on weaving of a fabric that Miller Cheetz had brought back from Central America, is an image that I have was part of, can I get that off the screen? Hopefully I can. Oh, there we go. Okay, perfect. Is part of how I first saw these buildings and what I thought of as sort of an important building, probably, and one that told a history of California that, as a historian, I might want to add some other things. I might want to reemphasize things, but at least made a history of California part of the story in the 1980s in San Diego in a way that nothing else was telling a story like this. When I moved back in 2010, I noticed that there were a lot of stories about what had happened to the home savings buildings. So home savings in 1998 had become Washington Mutual. It had stayed the largest savings and loan in the country from the mid-1950s until the mid-1990s. Washington Mutual is the largest savings and loan, which becomes demutualized as a bank in the 1990s. And then during the global financial crisis, Washington Mutual gets seized by the federal government and taken and handed over to J.P. Morgan Chase, essentially overnight. They didn't have locations on the West Coast. They wanted locations. They took the whole chain of locations sight unseen. And unfortunately, in that first round of the turnover, a number of the artworks were damaged. Okay, so this is West Portal here in San Francisco that was painted over that made the news. There was one, the Redwood City branch, which was originally a guarantee savings and loan, had a mural that was painted over. Whittier, California had a mural that was painted over. I'll show you at the end some of the other ones, but this is another example. This was actually done under Washington Mutual, where they went through the mosaic with the awning over the ATMs. So they put in ATMs, which these buildings didn't originally have, and then the signature is under, and everything else is above. Right? So not a decision that anyone who was paying attention to the value of these artworks would have made. One more example. Here the mosaic over the vault is still intact, but rather than being the place where the teller windows are, it's now a break room. Right? So you have a refrigerator, you have little lockers for the employees, and nobody gets to see this vault mosaic on an everyday basis the way it was intended. So it being the 21st century, I thought about how should I go about changing finding out about these things, right? I knew there was one in La Mesa. I knew there was another one in Pacific Beach in San Diego. So I figured two in San Diego County, maybe there are like 25 of these. This is like a brief article, and then I can move on with my 19th century stuff. So I started a website, now at adamaronson.com, and I said, how many of these are there? I said, tell me what you know about these. Is there one of these in your community? I knew there was one in Santa Monica. I had gone by that one. I knew there was one in Studio City. I had been to the one in Lombard and Venice, hence I had the picture of it before it had disappeared. But I wasn't sure. The one that disappeared is West Portal. And I just wasn't sure how many more there were. So as it turned out, there are many, many of them. Before Howard Amundsen dies in 1968, they're able to work on 75 of these. Before the Home Savings and the Sheets studio stopped working together in the 1990s, there are more like 200, about 100 inside of California, the others in Texas and Florida and Missouri and Ohio and Illinois, and there's one in New York City in Forest Hills. And I'd say that to some extent, the story of these things are well known, especially in Orange County and Los Angeles County, where the most of them are. But the people who knew these banks and knew this artwork are older now. So people under my age essentially don't know about them. My kids do, but that's because they've had to live with this project, you know, since 2010. But in general, people don't. And so I felt like it was important to try to get this story out there and be in a position to help people know what they're looking at, know they're part of this large series, and help preserve them. So I built a master inventory, which is on my website, of all the locations that have public commissions of art and architecture done through the Sheets Studio. I'll tell you more about what that means in a minute. And like, there are five of them in Missouri. So that's a really, my first book's about Missouri. I said, oh, this looks a lot like home savings in California, and they had no idea what I was talking about. So it's been about pulling all these pieces together and telling a large story, some of which, there is a Millard Sheets collection of papers at the Smithsonian that's 35 microfilm reels. The assistants who took over, Dennis O'Connor and Sue Hertel, their papers are now at the Huntington. So this material was available to some extent. There's a large and enthusiastic group of home savings ex-employees. Who are like on Facebook. There's a group called There's No Place Like Home Savings that I interact with. And they have a LinkedIn group. And I was able to interview about 75 people who either worked for home savings or who were part of the studio. And a lot of folks, like a former manager of the San Jose branch, lots of people from the Bay Area were able to help tell part of the story up here as well. So part of telling the history of this was getting beyond Millard Sheets' version of the story. He had kind of told the story so many times that he had perfected his vision, which was out of the blue, in 1953, he got a letter. And the letter said, own two pieces of property on Wilshire Boulevard, seen every building up and down the street, bored. Want buildings that will look good in 75 years. If interested, call. He claims he didn't know Howard Amundson at all. Though in fact their wives had been sorority sisters at UCLA, so they probably had been to some of the same parties. He had made his mark as a watercolorist. He was the head of the Scripps Art Department. And Amundson had recently gone from being in the insurance business to being in insurance and also now this new home savings and loan SNL that through a complicated set of things had gone from being mutual society to being something that you could actually own in this period. They go out to lunch. Amundson doesn't say anything about the stuff. As they go back towards downtown, he points out the window. There's one property. A little while later, there's the other. They get there. He says, so do you want to do it or not? Millard says, well, you know, we should talk about what it should look like, how much it should cost. He said, don't worry about all those things. Do it as if you were doing it yourself, for yourself. And Millard Sheets went home, and a little confused, he did a drawing, another drawing that Alan has. This is the way it appears in the book. It doesn't have a line in the middle in the original. The building becomes the National American Fire Insurance Company building at Wilshire and Serrano, which was later torn down for the Amundson Center by a drill stone. So there's a whole story of preservation and kind of self-destruction in some of the early buildings also that were torn down. But he brings this sketch. Amundson is on the phone. He waits 40 minutes in his office. And Amundson eventually says to the person on the phone, I'm looking at the most beautiful drawing. I can't wait till it's a building. Sheets then calls back again and says, I need to know about how much to spend, what kind of design, what did you like, what did you not like. He said, they get disconnected. Sheets calls back and he says, I think we got disconnected. And Evelyn Barty, Howard Amundson's secretary, says, no, he hung up on you because he wants you to do it yourself. And he does. He goes out and he creates this building. It has a large mosaic over the door. It has these sculptural pieces all along the edges. It's very much closed to the street. In the back, there's a whole courtyard with trees and special parking areas. He chose to get 20-year-old trees because he didn't want it to look like it was brand new. And there are ceramics. There's special places for Amundson's yacht trophies. It's a sort of custom-built building that he knows Amundson will like. When they walk through it, Sheets' story about it is that Amundson starts laughing. And he won't say anything, but he's laughing. And he gets increasingly frustrated. And he says, why are you laughing? And he says, well, I thought I was getting a beautiful office, but I'm also getting a building that will make money. People are going to line up. They're going to want to be part of this beautiful thing that we're doing together. That's the story. That's the way they tell it. But I feel like there has to be a context, right? That I'm a professor, so my job is to put it in a context, both an architectural context, a business context, an urban and suburban context. Things sometimes that aren't always put together. When we talk about mid-century modern architecture, we're almost always talking about residential works, or we're talking about very large office buildings with a kind of very distinctive, like, lever house kind of style to them. These are very unusual buildings in that way, right? They're commercial buildings. They're 2 stories tall. They're not all glass and steel, right? They're not kind of Philip Johnson boxes. They use lots of very traditional forms in terms of stained glass and gold tiles and ceramics. But they're put into a very contemporary, modern form from the mid-50s, in the period where they're really created. They continue to make them into the 1990s, which is also unusual in its own way. That they don't continue kind of to evolve as a style, but they build this as a brand. And the book really takes us through where that comes from and how it plays out. So we're going to get the brief version of the pre-story, and then I'm going to focus on some of our Bay Area examples, along with some of the Southern California examples, and then I'll take questions at the end. So the first thing that comes to mind, if we think about it not in terms of Sheets' story, but in terms of a wider version, is that Louis Sullivan had created these jewel box banks in the Midwest in the 1920s and earlier, in 19-teens, late zeros on through the early 1920s. Right? So Adler and Sullivan, the people who create the modern skyscraper, the office where Frank Lloyd Wright is a first apprenticed and then goes on to do his own work, Louis Sullivan, late in his career, are making these small, close to the street, two-story buildings that have these light atria inside. And I think that's an important place. Though Sheets never talks about these buildings, I think there's a clear line from there to the work that's being done. Similarly, if we think about projects that build in art and mythology into the architecture of a commercial space, the largest integrated project of that kind in the United States in the 1930s is Rockefeller Center. And the set of artists who work at Rockefeller Center have lots of interesting ties back to what happens with Sheets in Southern California. The design plan happens under people who had all worked for Bertram Goodhue. So Goodhue had done the California Tower in Balboa Park in San Diego, the LA Central Library, the Nebraska State Capitol. He dies, but the whole team that had been working with him go on to work at Rockefeller Center. So Lee Lowry, Hildreth Mayeri, the sculptors, the mosaicists, the enamel workers that you see at Rockefeller Center are people who had worked in Nebraska or worked at the LA Central Library. Who is picking the mythology, the kind of symbols that go on Rockefeller Center? A man named Hartley Burr Alexander, who teaches at Scripps, who is tied to Sheets, and that Sheets says, where is this guy who has the office next to me when he gets to Scripps? He never seems to be here. They say, well, he's in New York working for the Rockefellers. He comes back, and he gets into a conversation with Sheets about what artists know and what they need to know, and he says, basically, artists don't know enough about the history and the options of symbols to really make good decisions. They're sort of choosing at random. And Sheets gets really angry, but he, as he thinks about it over time, he decides that he's right. And he and Hartley Burr Alexander start to meet weekly to talk about sort of what do artists need to know. And Sheets, in this period, is not only the head of the Scripps department, he's also chosen to be the head of Otis. And so in this period, he's running the two art and design, two of the major ones other than Chouinard in Los Angeles at this moment. And he's pulling all these ideas in from these conversations with Hartley Burr Alexander. So first, like he had at Scripps, he likes the idea that you have a bunch of artists who work in different media all in the same space. He wants sculptors next to ceramicists, next to architects, next to painters. So they're all learning from each other and they're all able to integrate each other's work. And he wants them to think about what are the right art forms. A number of the people he hire believe very strongly in going out and using natural forms, you know, take animals from the area, trees and plants from the area, and put those in. And you'll see in Home Savings, a lot of those ideas come into the projects. Now, Sheets was a watercolorist, as I said, but he had also done other projects by 1953 that it wasn't like we're hiring a watercolorist to design a bank building without any intermediate step. He was never an architect. He was very clear that he wasn't licensed as an architect and that he always hired architects to work with him. But he did all the initial sketches, the kind of stuff that you see in color renderings here. So in 1939, he had done some enamel work at Mark Keppel High School in Alhambra, California, that was based on some of the same technology that Hildreth Mayeri had used on Radio City Music Hall, reflecting California history. And they're nice close-ups of a lot of the stuff on my website, because I had a blog with a lot of this information along the way. right before World War II, he's hired to do a set of air schools. He falls into a conversation with a construction person in Claremont, and they decide that they need to build these air schools extremely fast. The Army wants them, what will become the U.S. Air Force, ahead of Pearl Harbor. They know that they're going to need planes in the Pacific. And so they build 17 of these. They're in Texas. They're in California. They're what becomes Ontario Airport. They're what becomes the Phoenix Airport. There are lots of little ones, like in Uvalde and Chino and stuff, that stay either training schools or disappear. But there's a whole set of these air schools. And he works on the furniture. He wants to do artwork in each one of them. So he's getting a sense of what it's like to work with architects as he continues to think of himself mostly as a painter. After the war, he's starting to commission mosaics from the Ravenna Mosaic Company of St. Louis, actually run by a German man named Arno Heudig. So a totally confusing name, Ravenna, Heudig, but actually in St. Louis. That took a little while to sort out. And he's hired to do this set of centennial artworks for American Trust Company in Sacramento and in San Francisco. These large murals, one called Northern California in the Pageant of History and one called Northern California as it appears today. They hire Millard Sheets and Ansel Adams. So there's an Ansel Adams volume with photographs of Northern California at the same moment. And then there are these two images. This is one of them. They're both in the book, showing kind of the history, supposedly, of Northern California, and then showing Northern California as it appears today. And this, by the way, I think is the first time you see him trying to kind of place certain events that happened in various places, have some vision of that on the actual location. It becomes important for how Home Savings does their artwork. In the same moment, right, he says he's doing three, he feels like he has three lives worth of jobs, and that's definitely what it feels like when I try to write about it. He also does the Art of Daily Living exhibition at the LA County Fair with House Beautiful. Frank Lloyd Wright comes out to see it. And he's pulling in lots of what we think of as mid-century modern residential forms, including many of his Scripps College students, many of them GI Bill graduates, Harrison McIntosh, Sam Maloof, Gene and Arthur Ames are teaching with him. Lots of their work are in these houses, which are featured in the magazine and actually exist in Pomona in that moment. And then one of my favorite headlines, Burgers with Culture in Phoenix. Similarly, someone else in Claremont, a man named S. David Underwood, is an architect who's working for his high school buddy, who is the Bob of Bob's Big Boy. And he says, we're designing these new restaurants. We need some interesting artwork. So these sand painting Kachina figures are Sheets' contribution to coffee shops in Phoenix. And then they switch to what we think of as the tile version of Bob's Big Boy right after this. So Sheets has this experience that he's bringing into it. And he goes on to do some really, really interesting work in the Dallas Mercantile Museum, the Dallas Mercantile Office Building. On the 22nd floor, there were these double-sided mosaic pieces standing in Bakelite frames. The frames were being created by an engineer out of the Claremont Colleges. The mosaics were being done in Italy, and neither side wanted to know how the other side could work. They didn't want to let them know. So they put up the frames before they let the mosaicists in, and the mosaicists brought all their things. They put up curtains around themselves. They put up the mosaics, and they took the curtains down so that they couldn't see. They also designed all the furniture. They picked the colors of things like the upholstery and some of the designs. That's a Sheets design that was done in a tapestry because it was an executive office and they were worried all these hard surfaces would be too loud. So they wanted to add that tapestry to help quiet the room. This is where I'll be speaking on Wednesday, what's now the Marciano Arts Foundation Museum. In some ways, it's like a giant home savings building, but it had lots of other elements, just like the Scottish Rite building here that has lots of Sheets artwork, right? You need a very big auditorium, you need Masonic iconography, all those things play out differently in a space that's much larger, you know, as room for 400 to sit than it would in a bank building where you expect maybe a few dozen at a time. Sheets also got involved with the question about pedestrian malls and how to recreate downtowns. So 1962, the Pomona Mall is Sheets' brainchild for his hometown. It's the first pedestrian mall west of the Mississippi River. It's being done right at the same time as the Lincoln Street Mall that Victor Gruen is doing in Miami. And the U.S. National Conference of Mayors meets in Pomona because this is going to be the big strategy on how they're going to rebuild downtowns in the early 60s, is they're going to create pedestrian malls. Like Third Street Promenade in Santa Monica as well. And what they do is he studs that project with artwork as well. He goes space by space. They put up, this is Gene and Arthur Ames. This is Howard Amundsen. In the middle, those are two officials from Pomona. And they go space by space trying to create artwork, sculptures, and mosaics that kind of have it give a timeless feel to Pomona, which actually is quite older than the mid-60s, but these are all new artworks being created in the mid-60s that are reflecting, you know, Greek and Roman traditions all the way back with fountains, but also in a mid-century modern style. So when I say home-saving style, what do I mean? I argue that you have a very distinctive style created that wouldn't exactly have been what Sheets would have done on his own, despite the story. He's creating what he thinks Amundsen will want. His customers are people who had lived through the Depression, who want a place where their money will feel solid, you know, that they don't want necessarily a glass box as a place to keep their money. They want something that feels solid, timeless, that reflects, you have a lot of people from the Midwest who are moving to Southern California in this period. They want a sense of sort of something that's very well established and doesn't necessarily have the kind of neon and glass and steel of some of the things around them. I think he does so in a way that some people mock as looking like a mausoleum. But the savings and loan representative they talked to said mausoleums are okay, right? Money, saving money is about the investment. It's about time much later in the future. And so if your money sticks around, that's okay. This is what he starts with. When he gets that call, Home Savings owns a whole variety of buildings. Some of them, like the one that they tear down in Studio City, are quite streamlined and modern looking. Some of them are much older. But what they eventually come to after the first branch he designs, this one at 9245 Wilshire in Beverly Hills, is a whole jumble of symbols that get refined over time to be a collection of items for to get that timelessness across, that idea that there's something for the community, that it reflects family. So they're all different elements, right? You can see the shield getting and the windowless box of that two stories giving that sense of security. You'll have another picture in a minute, but these are those family items. You have parents and children on both sides. I think the next, there you go. Those are Renzo Fenci, the person he hires to do sculpture at Otis, is the person doing those designs. And there are a lot of family imagery that gets played into Home Savings all the way through. On the other hand, Fenci also does these Greek bathers in the back. So at this point, they haven't quite decided on one set of symbols that they want to get across. This has been destroyed, by the way. It's not there anymore. We don't think it exists. Sheets also thinks that the mosaics are a valuable tool and it can reflect the local industries. But what I argue about this first mosaic is that he learns that it's quite hard to do mosaics, and he hadn't quite realized how hard it was. Sheets ultimately hires people out of Gene and Arthur Ames, his colleagues' studio, who have actually been trained in mosaic. The two names here are Otis students that he worked with, and one of the things you can see in the book is that they don't reverse the design. Okay, so that's like a very elementary mosaic making mistake, and they don't end up cutting a lot of the tiles to contours, so it has a kind of pixelated look that doesn't work as well. Also in the book is the one from Santa Ana, which is like the revised version of this, where they got it right with the right team. About this is 56, and Santa Ana is, I think it's around 70. So it takes them a while to come back to this design. But his effort is to kind of show like people reaching at the stars, construction workers, gardening, and fishermen, but it doesn't quite really come across in this version the way it does later. So he realizes he needs to first go back to the folks in St. Louis to contract out some of these, and then later to get a whole set of people trained in mosaic work. They also have this whole history of banking in the stained glass windows and etching. And so you get like, you know, Sumerian coins and Greek coins and Native American coins. All ways that I think they're trying to glorify the experience of banking, but clearly not speaking in one register in this first building. But Amundsen is so pleased with what he sees that this becomes the model. He basically says, don't fix anything. And he's like, well, but there are these things we need to fix. They didn't quite work out. So they are able to refine the artwork, but the architecture stays very similar until after Amundsen dies in 1968. So when we talk about the Millard Sheets studio, as I said, he's a watercolorist. He's a designer. And the various people I know who work there said, this is what you would get, right? You would get a very quick sketch, whether it was of the artwork or the building, And then Milicic would go off to some business meeting somewhere else, and he'd expect in 3 weeks to come back and there'd be blueprints that would be able to turn this into a building. You know, we'd know exactly how long it would take to build, how much it would cost, all that kind of stuff. So Rufus Turner, Bob Kurtz, Bob Nilsson, David Underwood, there's a whole set of architects, and in the book I have a list of everyone I could find, their name, who worked in the studio. They were tasked with this work. This is the studio building they eventually built in Claremont. It's now an ophthalmologist's office, but it's still the Sheets' office was in this corner near the door. The architects were in this building in the back. This was an aviary, so that there are a number of birds, and they could be sketched from life from those birds. This was used to project the murals, and then there are tile rooms for the mosaics in the back of this building. So I have a number of pictures of people working in the buildings. That's David Underwood in the back, Sue Hertel and Millard Sheets here. Millard and Sue are clearly working on some sort of design. Millard would do all those initial sketches. The kind of work you see here, Sue, if it was going to become a full-scale cartoon for a mural or a mosaic, Sue's the person who created that. But the renderings were done from Sheets' work, like this, into either a final form for by Robert Jackson or by Sheets himself. And then the ones that are full-sized, like this one, Sue did all the work and all the color work in terms of picking, you know, which mosaic tile am I going to match to that color. This is the front of the Arcadia branch being done in full color in that room of the studio. We saw this tapestry earlier. Martha Menke was another Scripps graduate and around the same age as Sue Lautman Hertel. And she had trained with the Ameses in enamel and mosaic. She had no training in fabric arts. Millard Sheets said, we need a tapestry, take this design to Aubusson, France. And she went and oversaw the creation of this and then made fabric artwork a big part of her own artwork for the rest of her career. Nancy Colbath, also an early assistant, she actually designed the Santa Monica mosaic, so that's probably, I don't know if Alan, you have that design in the frame or not. Do you have that one in your gallery?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's Millard holding it with Nancy, and then they're working on it behind. That's a publicity photo. Nancy and Sue and Martha are the ones who really figure out how to do the mosaic work in California. They continue to hire Scripps graduates. They continue to make it work. Their major success is the Masonic Building, where the Marciano Arts Foundation is now. It's a four-story artwork on the side of the building. And Martha told me about how she was just completely overwhelmed by the process of doing that and trying to get it all right and like feeling like some of it was being sent out before she could even match them up because it was just so big. They had nowhere to lay it all out. Right in that period, 1961, she meets Dennis O'Connor, who's a sculpture graduate of the Royal Academy of London, has come back to Claremont because that's where his first wife was from, and he's looking for something to do, and they get him interested in mosaic work. And he becomes the person who stays in the studio from 1961 until he dies in 2002, doing this kind of work. He never does the designs. He's colorblind. Which many people who worked with him didn't even know because he was so good at being able to tell the colors based on the grays. But he becomes the real master of the hands and the contours and the face and really creates a very vibrant set of the mosaics that can match the vibrancy of the sheet sketches. That's a lot of that is Dennis's work. What he's piecing together here is on the front of the Detroit Public Library, which is also a really, really amazing mosaic that's on my website. So in terms of what all this means beyond a straight art history is that they were really these, as I argue, suburban landmarks, right? The way I was finding them before I had a master list of them was I could get off the highway and go to what seemed like a Main Street and Main Street corner, and if you know, I could do it in Burbank and Pasadena and various other places, and I could find these buildings, right? That they're sort of in the right place, and they're able to kind of be this prominent local landmark. I tell the story of the Compton branch in the book. It's the only branch that's ever closed. Part of it is the very dramatic change in Compton between 1958 and when it's closed, which is 1981. But Compton is much like the other places they're building in that moment, which include Lakewood and Pasadena and Burbank and Encino. Right? The hope is that these are going to be these new track communities full of prosperous families that will go forward and want to have money invested here, and that money will then reward both home savings and the local communities. It works in Compton, by the way. Through the entire period that Compton is majority African American, into the period where it starts to be majority Latino, Compton continues to function well as a branch, but they decide that too many people are basically coming in and cashing checks rather than actually putting money in the bank, and they decide to close the branch in that moment. Home Savings talks about, in their own records, about how they tried to stop redlining in the LA area, that they got together Mark Taper and all the people, the heads of all these other banks, and that they made a proposal about stopping redlining before it was legally required to do so, and that other people said no. But, you know, I only have it from their side, so I can only go with telling it with a little skepticism in that way. The Lakewood branch is another example of a branch that was torn down, and they put up a tower later. The near freeways, in particular, they decide to build much taller structures, where on kind of main streets they want to build these two-story structures. So this Lakewood branch, they decide is sort of close enough to the freeway to be seen from a distance, so they eventually tear this down and build a much taller office branch where they have office space up above. Here's a look at the Burbank branch at night. You can see those very prominent home saving signs, the shield, the family, and the name. Like, those are the brand. Sort of those are how they get marked. They use them, as you've seen already, in calendars. They use them in advertisements and television and radio, right? They have a very, you know, they, like, if you go on eBay, there are lots of like keychains and t-shirts, right? They are very strong, and they keep this brand. From the very beginning, Sheets talks about how the home saving shield is something that he did sort of in an afternoon. And then it's everywhere. You know, by the time Home Savings closes, they have 500 branches. So 200 have some Sheets studio or other artwork. 300 are just two-story buildings with gold tiles, and the shield. And they still get some of that information across. Though very late, like there was, I was looking up the address, which I have to find in my computer. They build a small tower on Market Street, very different, like a postmodern building, that I think is actually already not there. It was built in the early 80s. But I can look up the details for you. So this was the first tower they built. Amundsen says, I want to build these small buildings. And Sheets says, well, we're building this pedestrian mall, and you agreed to be a part. I want Buffums at one end, and I want a big home savings tower at the other. This is the first tower they build. And it convinces Amundsen that if you are the kind of the largest building in the area and you can be seen from far away, it's worth it. But they continue to use those same forms. I think when we think about how does this match up what we normally think of as mid-century modern architecture, this is a better example because those dark lines of the dark material gives it a sense of floating, you know, very rectilinear. It's emphasizing its height with those HS window covers here. That's an H. And so I think there are ways in which, you know, it's playing off what we think of often in suburban houses of those kind of screens that people use. In the front or in the back to get light but have privacy. It's using some of those forms we often attach as mid-century modern that aren't necessarily the Mies van der Rohe, you know, glass and steel, in just a very different form. You know, I think these buildings have been ignored because they are so different than what we often think of or the things that have been venerated to date. The first one that was really dedicated to its location was the Hollywood branch. They tore down the NBC radio studio that was an Art Deco building on this corner to build this branch. But they build in a whole history of Hollywood because they feel like this is a space where the first movie had been, the first talkie had been shot. And so it was important to tell that history. So there's a large mural inside. There's all these figures on the outside, including like Julie Andrews as Mary Poppins and Charlie Chaplin and lots of others. They have a big plaza out front. This is the first one that's not on the corner, but diagonal across the space, which as a number of the later ones are. And they try to make it a space for that. As I said, Amundsen really wanted to keep things exactly the same. This is an example of that. But the Studio City branch and the Beverly Hills branch, there's some differences in the back, but in terms of the front of the buildings, the mosaics are different, and the mosaic gets much better by 1969 at the bottom there in Studio City, but it's really the exact same design, so just sort of oriented slightly differently. After Howard Amundsen dies of a heart attack in 1968, his nephews take over, and you see, I think, some of the most interesting buildings created right in that period. 1972 is also the year they're allowed to move out of Orange and LA County into the San Francisco Bay Area and San Diego, and so some of these designs are also responding to new questions and concerns in those spaces. either based on their own design interests, or increasingly in the Bay Area, they run into planning and zoning commissions that say, you know, you've been building the exact same building everywhere. How can you claim it's perfect for our community if you're just going to plop it down in? They have issues in Santa Cruz and in Walnut Creek that I talk about in the book. Those are two of the main places where they have these issues. So Santa Monica, they take that same building we just saw and they bend the arms in a little bit. Okay, that's the big innovation there. That's also Anaheim is the exact same building in terms of the design. San Jose, though, which the design is on the corner there, that's from the side. This is the more dramatic angle, that it's almost like a stop sign. It's these two interlocking design pieces, and they have mosaics on all sides. And they're really a new design. They're trying new subjects for the mosaics and a new setup for the design that I think is a bold break in this moment. This is my personal favorite, where they build an element in the parking lot of mosaic just so they can build those sculptures on it to have those dolphins leaping over a wall of ocean. And they have this massive 100-horse history of horseback riding in a very horse-centered part of LA County in Rancho Palos Verdes, Rolling Hills. This is the West Portal branch. This is the first effort to kind of think about the Pacific world so that you have families again, you have these couples, but they represent people from all across the Pacific. In the book, you can see a little better that it says like Australia, Japan, Polynesia, California. I forget what the fifth one is right now. Can almost read them. South America, it looks like, I think, because I'm reading. So Japan, Australia, California, South Pacific, something. Anyway, I can't see what it says right now. But an effort to bring in the Pacific world, a slightly different sort of sculpture from John Edward Svensson there. That's based on a cactus. Sheets gave him, and I said, was this your idea, John? And he said, no. And he handed me the sketch that Miller Sheets has given him to say, make a cactus. Why a cactus at West Portal, I'm not sure, but that was the design. And there is a bird sitting on top of the cactus there, too. And this is the Pacific Beach branch in San Diego. So they're breaking up that windowless facade. It's slightly taller, and it has a new set of arches in. It's pulling a little bit from kind of a mission style to some extent with getting in, because you'll see the next one has more of the coloring. Very prominent sea lion there in the front. And then what I think of as the snapshot history of California being told in those six figures across the top. I talk in the book about who gets included and why not. And so Millard Sheets, from around when Amundsen dies, talks about retiring to Gualala. He buys land, he builds a house, and year after year, Mary Sheets, his wife, moves up there. And he claims year after year he's going to leave the studio and go there. It takes him a number of years. But around 1978, he finally does move to Gualala and spends his time painting and not doing these home savings designs. But home savings continues to work with Sue Hertel and with Dennis O'Connor and then with other artists after that to continue to create these artworks. In this first chapter, I do talk about the zoning, right? So Mountain View said you can't put your white travertine box. So this is basically the exact same design with the arches that you saw in San Diego, but now in brick. Somehow Mountain View thought that was okay, as enough of a difference. Some of these fights, they feel like they're really being singled out. Walnut Creek, they want to build a three-story building because they want a regional headquarters for the whole Bay Area. And they say, we're not going to let you build that big. Nothing is allowed to be that big. And then the next month, they approve the San Francisco Federal Savings and Loan Building, this brutalist structure you see here. And then Home Savings goes back to them and say, like, well, why could they build it and we couldn't build it? So they were actually allowed to build it. So they build what doesn't look really very much like a normal Home Savings, other than it has a mosaic over the door, just sort of down the block from this Walnut Creek building that was built for San Francisco Federal Savings and Loan. While Sheets is in charge, the artwork all stays sort of before the 1906 earthquake is the end. Like if you go look at that very long one that's a freeze of California, of San Francisco history, it tends to end right around 1906 because after the 50s, he decides not to do contemporary things. In this late period, lots of contemporary things get into the artwork that hadn't been there before. You can see the space shuttle in the back around in the test pilots. This is in the branch in Lancaster, California. At the very end, other artists are pulled into some of these, Marlo Bartels, Astrid Preston, Richard Haas. This is a branch in Monterey Park. Home Savings doesn't put the Chinese lettering on there. Washington Mutual does, and then now Chase does as well. But this ceramic tile has bamboo on the edges and has a, essentially it's supposed to be a Chinese village and an American village being contrasted in that space. So they are trying to respond to the local community in that way. It's done in ceramic mostly, but that sun at the top, they went out and they met with Dennis O'Connor, who was living out in the desert at that point, and they asked him how to do the mosaics, and they learned to do a very small mosaic. This is Richard Haas's Skylivy for the Home Savings Tower in Los Angeles. So this is seven stories up over a parking garage, but it's still trying to have that panorama of Los Angeles feel in it. This is another local example of late home savings work in Daly City. There's a long mural over the teller window, and then there's one on the outside. His artwork, slightly different style, sort of based on photographs, but still trying to get a sense of family, leisure, and local landmarks, all still being done all the way to the end of the projects in around 1991 is the final one. So that takes me to my last piece, which is just this question of preservation. You know, as I said at the beginning, they're buildings that are kind of had this problem of being mid-century modern in a way that was different than other mid-century modern, that they were commercial rather than residential, that they weren't giant office buildings. So they were easier to alter. Home Savings sells a number of them to MetLife at one point because they decide it's better for their books to rent their own buildings back than to own the land and the buildings. And so there's one in Santa Monica that's recently been, they're working on landmarking and it's being appealed, but it's currently under a landmark protection at 26 in Wilshire. This was a different Santa Monica branch that was built in 1998 and destroyed in 2001. And at that point, we have laws in California and federally that say, you know, artists are supposed to have their artwork protected. Dennis O'Connor got a letter in the mail that said, like, we're taking this building down. If you want to come get your mosaic, you can come get it. But, you know, they weigh 1,000 pounds or whatever, right? It's stone and glass and cement and all that. As far as I know, nobody cut this out and took it home, but it could be in somebody's backyard. So if you know that person, please let me know. There were two of them. There was one on this side and there was one on the other side as well. This is the West Portal mural that was painted over. They were all, like the one in the San Jose airport that they were worried about destroying, they could all have been rolled off the walls. And it's unclear, you know, even if it was painted over, like we have lots of examples of like Renaissance things were painted over. I don't know if it was also thrown out. I'm not sure what happened to the three that I know of that were painted over, Redwood City, West Portal, and Whittier, if they can be recovered in some way. This is something that easily could be recovered, okay? This is a mosaic that was painted over in Long Beach. At one of my events in LA County last month, someone said that they live in Long Beach and they're working on getting it to be revealed again. And some of the examples are just sort of silly, okay? This is Lombard and Van Ness. That's what it looked like when it was built, okay? And they planted these little trees in front. And then this is pretty much what it looks like. As far as I know, it still looks like this. They have not. I talked to someone in the city who was going to cut the trees down, but they haven't been cut down yet. So people are going to be very surprised that they have these very beautiful mosaics right on their corner that they may not even realize are there because you have to be way up under those trees to be able to see them. Because this right here is that corner, right? So they're still there, but they're just hiding behind the trees. And then this is my final slide from Santa Barbara that I think there's just a way in which it's hiding in plain sight, right? This is a story that people over a certain age remember all those television commercials and calendars and key change and all those things. But you know, I'm 40 this year, and I think people younger than 40 for the most part in California aren't going to have that history. And I felt it was important to get this story out there and be part of working to preserve it. So that's why I wrote the book.